It's Sunday and I'm working at the University of Cape Town campus. We're going to have a cabinet meeting in South Africa today. I'm sure we're going to find out that there's going to be severe restrictions, and I'm sure the university is going to make plans to close many of the campuses. What I want to talk to you about is an introduction to two videos. I'm going to use the same introduction for two videos, and that's on the data analysis of open data that's available for the coronavirus. Now, the Wolfram Repository, Data Repository, has three data sets that's available. It comes from the WHO and it's updated very regularly. Just mind that when you do the data analysis, it's going to look slightly different from the data analysis that I'm going to do because it is regularly updated. It does lag a few days behind, so you're going to see data up till a couple of days ago. So we're going to do two videos. I'm going to show you data analysis, one on the medical data that the WHO has made available, and one on the epidemiological data. So as I said, the same introduction video is going to be for both. So I do have courses on the use of the Wolfram language for data analysis, specifically for the healthcare related field. The Wolfram language, of course, lends itself beautifully to data analysis. And then the data repository has a lot of open source data curated by the Wolfram research, so that we can use the data in our analysis. So there's a lot of data analysis videos. Wolfram themselves make some, but I want to give you just something from the perspective of a doctor, from a surgeon working in a hospital where we are preparing for the management of these patients. So have a look at these the videos. As I said, one is going to be on the epidemiological data and one is going to be on the medical data and the use of the data analysis. If you want to learn more about the use of the Wolfram language, of course, I do have courses. You can get a University of Cape Town certificate through Coursera if you take the course on the use of the Wolfram language for biostatistics. So let's go in and explore this data set. Some of the data is sparse. It's difficult, I think, for the world to gather this type of data. In as much as a worldwide effort to try and collect this data. So some of the data is going to be a bit sparse, specifically when it comes to data, say for instance about the symptomatology, the symptoms of the patients, but it is a large data set and we can still learn a lot from it, and that's what all this is about. When I teach healthcare statistics, data science, data analysis, I really urge people to get to the story that the data is trying to tell you. There's information locked in that, and that information is knowledge, and that is exactly what we need right now. So let's analyze some of this data. I'll show you how to use the Wolfram language to do this. So let's go have a look. So here we are in the Wolfram desktop. As I mentioned in the other video that I've made on the coronavirus using the Wolfram data repository, data on the coronavirus pandemic, is that you can do this in your browser in the Wolfram cloud, absolutely free of charge, but I'm using the Wolfram desktop here on my own system. The first place to go and find out some useful information on the coronavirus, of course, is on Wolfram Alpha, and you can see I've just passed the string coronavirus as an argument to the Wolfram Alpha function here, and it's being interpreted as a medical diagnosis, and you can get some information there. You can also, of course, click on there and interpret it as a species specification, and you're going to get some information about the taxonomy and the size, etc., of this virus. So always remember the Wolfram Alpha there. What we are interested in is the Wolfram Data Repository, and we're going to use resource search as a function, and again pass the string coronavirus to get the information on the data sets that are available, the curated data sets on the coronavirus. Now, this comes from the WHO, I think, via Johns Hopkins. This data is available as open source data, curated here for the Wolfram data repository, so easy for us to use inside of the Wolfram language. The data is updated regularly, but it's not completely up to date. So the data that I'm working with here today is up to date for today. It will always be up to date as far as what is available on the servers, but it's going to be lag a few days behind the actual date. And we can see the three data sets that are out there. We've already looked at the patient medical data in another video, and I'll certainly put that information in the description down below. And here we're going to look at the epidemic data set. And for those of interest, for you interested and with knowledge in the genetic sequencing, there's a fantastic data set on that as well. But in this video, we're going to look at the epidemic data. So let's open this up, and we're going to import that with the resource data function, as we can see there. Let's increase the size of the screen here. I think that might make it a bit easier to read. Let's go to 150% and we'll go full screen here.
that might make it easier for us to read. So resource data, and then I'm just passing the name, as we can see the name here, epidemic data for novel coronavirus COVID-19, and I'm passing that exactly as a string, and that is going to import the data to my local system from the Wolfram Data Repository. So that might just take a second or two, especially way down here in the Southern Hemisphere where I am accessing this data set from. And there we go, fantastic data set. We can see some of the columns there, and it goes on and on. We can scroll to the right. Deaths, recovered cases, confirmed cases, geoposition, country and administrative data. So typical for epidemiological data, and we see some of this data is saved as time series themselves. So that column with a cell actually has a bunch of values in it, and you can see the time series here already until the 13th of March, 52 data points. When you run the code, you're going to see different data points. As always, when you start analyzing the data, let's look at the statistical variables. Those are the column names, column headers, and I'm going to use the normal function. Epidata is the name of my data set, the first row, the keys that I'm interested in, and we see the statistical variables, the administrative division, country, geoposition, confirmed cases, recovered cases, and deaths. Now, as always, with the data set that comes from the data repository, you might be interested in some more information on that. And we can use the resource object function, pass the name of the data set, and I'm going to store this in a computer variable called epidata resource. And that resource has a lot of properties in it. And always when it has these properties, I like to use the manipulate function. And I pass this list as something that I can select inside of manipulate. So I'm using this temporary computer variable here n. And I'm going to just, we can just select any of those properties using manipulate. So I can drop down there and just click on any of these, and it'll give me the information from that property instead of having to type in all of the different properties every time. So certainly something I like to do. So as with epidemiological data, let's start looking at a couple of countries, and let's have a look at how there's been this increase in the cases as a pandemic, as any pandemic will develop. When we talked about the medical data, I did mention, and I'll mention it here as well, even though if we scroll up, we see these strings here, China, Sweden, that is not how it's saved inside of the data set. It is saved as entities, and if you just look for the string value there, you're not going to find that. So we have to save this as an entity. Now, there's various ways to extract an entity, just using freeform, using the entity function, but I'm using the interpreter function here, as I'm saying. Please interpret Italy, passed as a string, as a country, please. So that if I run that and I store it in a computer variable such as Italy, this is this entity here, is what is saved inside of the data set. So that is what I would have to search for. So let's create this new data set that only has data on Italy inside of it. How would I do that? There are a couple of ways that I can do. What I'm going to do here is just use notation straight from a data set. So I start with a data set name, and then I'm going to select, and I'm going to say match Q. So in the medical data, I actually use different syntax to do exactly the same thing. So there's quite a few ways that you can go about it. So here's another way for you to go about it. So I'm saying match Q. So it's only going to select it if that is indeed included. And what do I want to match? Well, I'll go down the country column, and I use the little ampersand there to go down that whole column row by row. Therefore, we use the hashtag symbol there, so hashtag country. And the country we're looking for is this entity value, Italy. So it's only going to include data from Italy. So let's run that, and we see there's only one row dedicated to Italy. Some countries you'll see that it goes by province or territory or state, and we'll get quite a bit of information. But for Italy, it's all captured in the same way. And we can see the time series here, and we can see little graphs. So we can see this rapid growth in the number of cases there. So let's have a look at that. Confirmed cases. I want to extract that. So I'm going to say Italy epi. All the rows. See the double square brackets here. So I'm using indexing row comma column. So all the, as far as the rows are concerned, give me all the values. And then in the confirmed cases. So what we are going to get back, if there's only one row, so it's only going to give me this row, this column, so it gives me back this time series. Now the time series data that comes from all over the world is being captured by different people, and let me be brutally honest, there's a bit of work to be done when you want to extract this data. First of all, let's just do a dateless plot on this data. And so we're going to say a dateless plot, Italy confirmed cases TS, and putting that inside, as you can see here, inside of curly braces to make it a list. And the image size is large, and I've just done some plot labels there. And this is the unfortunate picture that we can see here, starting on 27th of January here until after the 9th of March. We can see the scale here, the number of cases are very, 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 very unfortunate. We can see this rapid rise in the number of cases there. Let's look at the recovered cases. So let's just extract that time series. I'm just using indexing there, so all the rows in there is just a single row of the recovered cases. And now we can plot them both. So let's plot them with a show function, so we can do two dateless plots in exactly the same plot. And we can see the lag behind in the recovered cases as far compared to the recovered cases compared to the confirmed cases. And we can see also the date of this information lags a bit behind. But certainly there is a good rise here in the number of recovered cases being documented. Now, I want to extract the numerical values only. So this dateless plot has done a wonderful job of just extracting the actual values and the dates so that we can have these beautiful lines, but to do it by hand takes a bit of extraction. Unfortunately, there's also a bit of discrepancy between each of the time series. You have to extract these values in a bit of a different way, and you'll have to play around. You'll have to play around a little bit. So I'm going to, for this instance, I know what works here. I've looked at it before. I'm going to use the apply function, and I want to apply list to the Italy confirmed cases TS time series. Now, if we look at here, this is what I've saved it as, Italy recovered cases TS. That was just my computer variable name, and I just went for that cell and that column. So I got this time series object there, and this is how I'm going to extract it. I know that that works well in the extraction of that. And now this is what I get. Time series 52, if I click on that, I see inside of that I have the actual numbers, which is what I'm after. Now, if I can spell this correctly, that N should certainly not be there. Let's take that away. The other way to construct this apply function, of course, is shorthand notation and to say list at Italy confirmed cases, TS. Was my variable name there. So let's just correct that all now, because I'm going to put some information in the description down below so that you can download the notebooks for yourself. So I have this in this format, but it's still not what I'm after. I'm after this little bitty here. That's what I'm after. So all I'm going to do is ask for this again, just via shorthand, and pass that to the normal function. And let's see what I get from that. Now I get this nested list where I have a date object here and the number of cases. So I'm certainly getting closer to what I want to do. And that's what you have to do with this data information. You just play around with it a little bit until you get back exactly what you want. Now this is great for me because I'm going to pass this as the values at least to a time series model fit function. There we go. Because what we are going to try and attempt to do here is just to create some model. Now, there's certainly not enough numbers here. It's too early in the pandemic to just use very simple time series model fits here to predict the future. But certainly, there's enough data here for us to attempt this. And I'm going to simplify it. I'm just going to use a couple of functions here. But then just to give you the idea of the power that's locked up here and that you could unleash. So I'm returning exactly this list. I could have saved it in a computer variable, but I haven't. So there it still is, the normal, and then do all of that. But what I'm extracting is only the numbers. So it's these second of the set of elements, the nested values. So I'm only extracting those numbers. So I'm just passing all of those sequential numbers, 0, 0, 0. You can see it started at 0 cases in Italy on that day, 0, 0, and then it started to ramp up. So I'm only passing that specific sequence of values to the time series model fit. So this is time series analysis, very complicated topic. And what I'm not going to do here is pass a specific type of model here. So I'm not going to say autoregression or moving average or autoregression moving average or integrated version of that ARIMA or SARIMA, which is season, build seasonality into that. If you know anything about time series analysis, you can certainly specify here what time series you want. I'm just going to let the Wolfram language decide on its own what to do based on the values that I do give it. And you can see here already, it's giving me back a time series model and with a bit of information on that. And it's chosen the seasonal ARIMA there for us as the method for constructing this model. Now it has a bunch of properties. Again, remember you can use the manipulate function to go over all of these, but that's certainly all the properties that are available in my model. I can get more information on the model by just passing the model to the normal function. And you can see the information on the SARIMA process. The SARIMA process, remember, is the function side of the Wolfram language, and you can see some information on that there. So what I want to do now is use the time series forecast function. There we go, the time series forecast function. I'm passing my model, which I've saved under TSM Italy, and I want the next 10 days. Can you predict for me, can you forecast the number of cases that we're going to see in the next 10 days after the date at which this data stops? I'm going to pass that to a list line plot. So first of all, I'm going to do the dates that I do have, and that is this property temporal data of my model. So that's the actual values that I do have, and then I'm going to use time series forecast to plot a prediction of what we might see in Italy. And where we stand in the epidemic and with the SARIMA model, unfortunately, that's what it looks like. Now, pretty sure that's hopefully or not how it's going to pan out, but this was all just set by default. And certainly if you are familiar with time series analysis, you can do a much better job at this. But I wanted to show you just how easy it is just to then plot the data that we do have and then the forecast that we can make from a model. So certainly, as far as this very simplified version here is concerned, those cases, of course, does not look good at all. Now, let's go just in contrast to that to a place where we have already seen that the number of cases has started to plateau and even come down. And if we go right back up to the data, we'll see the first row there is on Hubei. So I'm going to call it Hubei confirmed cases time series. So I'm only extracting that time series from row one. And there we go, it is indeed a time series. And you can see the little plateau that has gone there. Now to extract these values from that time series, I had to do something different. It was captured in a different way. So instead of what we did for Italy, this is what worked for me. Again, just applying the list function to those values. And I've had to use this indexing to extract that. And then I've passed that all to the flatten function so that I have this number of cases that we've had before. Now, this time I'm going to pass all of these numbers to the time series model fit again. And this time I'm specifying the method that I want the time series analysis to be. And that's going to give me my model. Remember, I can extract all of those things from the model, but what I want to do, again, all the properties, but what I want to do is a list line plot of the actual values that we have now, these, and then the time forecast over what is going to happen the next 10 days. And we can see certainly the difference here in Hubei province in China as far as the forecast is concerned. So please do a much better job than I've done here. I just want to show you how easy it is to use the Wolfram language to do time series analysis. I couldn't help myself. I just wanted to look at the United Kingdom as well through family that I do have in the United Kingdom. So remember, I have to pass this as, or find at least an entity value for United Kingdom. I'm going to use the select function on the epidata again so that I only have a time or data set at least that has the United Kingdom inside of that data set. and the one that contains the real data here is this first row, is what we are interested in. So let's look at this time series of this first row. So I'm just using normal indexing there, row one, and then the confirmed cases. And we pass that, and I'm saving that as a computer variable. And let's have a look at that plot where we stand for this data set as far as the UK is concerned. And it unfortunately looks the same as in other places, in that we see this this jump. Now I'm going to do this all in one. The extraction of this, again, a little bit different from the way we did for Italy before and for Hubei province. But I'm also just going to very simplified. I'm just going to use Serima there. I have a model, and we can again look at what the forecast looks there for the next 10 days after the values that are available here. So certainly, again, predicting this increase. One more. Let's look at Australia entity. There we go, Australia. I'm just going to have Australia as the selection criteria there. And we can see it was broken down into all these different territories, New South Wales, Victoria, South Australia, Western Australia, etc. And I just want to show you how easy that would be for us just to have a look at the time series of all of that. So have a look at the line of code there. What I wanted to show you there is just if you click on any of these, we're going to see that time series for that row. So the time series for that row, this is how I extracted it in this instance. And if we do a dateless plot on all of those combined, I'm saying up to number 7, because certainly if we go look here, this last one, I don't want this empty row here to be included. But there we can see the numbers for the different territories there. And we can see the Northern Territory there with the at the bottom with the lowest infection rate. One more thing we might have a look at this confirmed, this epidemiological data, of course, is the different countries. So what we've done here is to start with the epi data, all the data in the country column. Please return that for me as a list. So I've passed that to the normal function here. Delete all the missing values for me, delete the duplicates, and then sort it for me. So if we do that, we can see this alphabetical sort of all the countries that have been affected. And just look at that sorry list. Unfortunately, very few places have been spared from this epidemic, this pandemic, I should say. Let's plot this as a geographics. And we can certainly see here Antarctica seems to have been spared, but everywhere else looks pretty much, unfortunately, affected by this. I'm going to group by country, so I'm going to use epidata, so that's normal data set notation, epidata, and then the group by function, so group by country, and I want the totals, and I want the confirmed cases, and from confirmed cases, I just want the last value. Because confirmed case is going to be a time series, but I just want the last value inside of that, which will give us the latest view as far as this data set's concerned. So there we go. China, Italy, Iran, South Korea, Spain, all the unfortunate things we've seen in the news there. So let's just go for a region plot here, a geo-value region plot. And if we set the plot range to about 5,000, it's going to give us a good color difference between all the countries as far as to differentiate in a map kind of how the different countries have been affected. And you see the legend here on the left-hand side. So the yellow would be for less than 1,000 cases. And then the higher up we go, we do know that China was the first epicenter. Of course, unfortunately, Iran there. And then, of course, Europe that has become the new epicenter for the continuation of this pandemic. So let's just have a look at the United States. If we want to use this epidemic data, of course, there's the entity, and I'm only going to select cases from the USA. We've seen how to do that now with a select function. And let's do a geo-region plot of that. I am going to group by the administrative division. That is going to give us the different states, I think. Washington, New York, California, Massachusetts. There we see the different states. And I want the last value again of the confirmed cases. And the plot range, we're dealing with a lot fewer patients here when we compare that to the whole world. So I'm going to set the plot range to about 100 so we can get some idea of how the different states in the United States have been affected. And you can see Texas there, you can see Miami, you can see California with the highest number of cases, unfortunately. Let's do the top 100 countries. That is always a plot that we might want to include when we talk about something like the epidemiological data. So I'm going to sort the epi data. I'm going to group by country. Again, I'm going to take the last value, and we're only going to take the first 11. So I'm using indexing there. It's saying give me the first 11 because I am just doing that group by, and I only want the first 11 back. Otherwise, it becomes too much to plot. So there we go, the top countries there. Now, when I ran this data set before, there's certainly been a cruise ship or two that has been included in this. And I see in the latest data that has been removed. And if it still shows up for you, what you can do then is just use this key drop function. So key drop function, you can specify then what you want, what key you want dropped. And that for me is not a country. Cruise ship was one of the countries that did appear in this list. So certainly if you want to remove that. So normal is, of course, is going to give us the entity themselves. And then we're going to see how many cases there are. Again, we could drop that in the association if that was available, if the cruise ship still appeared. Cruise ship still appeared here because we're just interested in the countries. But now we can just do a normal bar chart with this association. I'm setting the plot theme to business here. It's a well-drawn plot here. And we can see China here at the bottom still with the most number of cases. And then we can see Italy, etc. Just a little bit of code here. If you just want to extract the values separately, there's the countries, and I'm converting them to names here so that we can add them as far as the plot is concerned. We can extract from the association that we have there the values. So now we have the values and the name, and we can use a bar chart, a different type of bar chart, so that we have a legend on the right hand side that shows us the different countries and colors. So two ways for us just to set that up with the numbers. In case you wanted a different look for your plot, there's some useful information for you there how to extract that. So all in all, pretty grim from a medical point of view, from a surgeon's point of view, where we are looking in my own country about how to deal with this pandemic and what it might mean to our health services. It's great to have this information available. The Wolfram language makes it very easy for us to extract. And there's certainly a ton more information in these data sets that I haven't touched here. That if you have some questions that we can perhaps sit together, I'm quite happy to help you through this data set and to extract some of this data. Just leave some comments down below. You know how to contact me. This is also done for my students on Coursera, where I have three courses, one on medical statistics, introduction to medical statistics, which is the leading course, of course, on medical statistics. As far as the massive open online courses are concerned, I also have a course specific to biostatistics using the Wolfram language. And for those students, I hope I'm going to leave a message on Coursera for you to watch these videos and that you find these successful. As I said, there's a ton more information on here, some information that we, every one of us, can use locally, and certainly some of this data and the results thereof that we will look at locally in the hospitals and the academic complex at the University of Cape Town, where I am a surgeon.